Praise you, Lord. You've heard me say a few times before, give this testimony that in March next month will be 20 years that I went to the prayer conference in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and Jim Martin came to that same conference. I don't know that we even really met at that conference, but we were aware of each other, okay? But we were there at Pastor Dave's conference, and that's our meeting place. That's where we first made connection. Since then, over the last decade, Jim and Kathy Martin have become an incredible part of Candy and my life and the life here at the Family Prayer Center of Immokalee, and we to their group there, to our extended family in Dayton. Especially over the last 6-7 years, an incredible bond relationship. Some of our best friends, and the main thing that bonds us together is we love to be together. We think a lot alike. We talk a lot alike. We joke. That's all great. That's all well and good, and it really is. It's what we need. Fellowship is very important, but it's the bond in the spirit and the thinking alike according to the Word of God and the doctrine. And Jim is one of the few people. It's not because we are special, but you don't stand up here as a pastor week after week and study and pray and meditate to give as pure a doctrine as you possibly can, and then just invite anybody in to say whatever they want to say and just, you know, do whatever they want to do. And so Jim is one of the few guys that come, or men or women that come and stand and preach, especially extensively. And I to him as well. He doesn't have a lot of people. And so I have that privilege in his pulpit as well. But these are wonderful people, and they've become family to you. And Jim has a most wonderful wife. He's got a wife like I've got, Kathy. She keeps him straight, and he needs to be kept straight. So would you give my great big wonderful friend Jim Martin a great big hand? Amen.
Hallelujah. He's right. She keeps me in order, in line. She does it with great enthusiasm. So I might as well let you meet her. Kathy, please stand. I am blessed. Here a week ago, we celebrated 35 years of marriage. And I think of it as 35 years of heaven on earth. I don't know what she thinks of it as. But nevertheless, praise God. It's really good to be here. Really good to be here. You know, when I come here, I know the foundation of teaching that you have received throughout the year. And because of that, it makes it easier for me to minister. Because I can't, and I know your pastor would bear witness with this, I mean, we can't just go into any church and teach the way that we teach the people in our own church. And that's because over the years, line upon line, precept upon precept has been laid. It's a process that takes time. You don't realize it's happened, but it's happened. And those who are regular attenders of this church, whether you call yourself a member, I mean, I don't know, that's however you term it for yourself, those of you that attend regularly, you have had a foundation established in you. Whether or not you have paid full attention to everything that's been taught, the very fact that you're here, your hearing has picked up on this. Even if you fall asleep during the sermon. Seriously, your hearing has picked up on this, and it's gone on the inside. You know, every now and then I'm reminded of this fact when parents come to me and they talk about, you know, their child, the child that I thought wasn't paying a bit of attention, and then after the service, the child repeats something I said in the sermon. And I'm thinking, but the kid was there coloring, you know, playing with his iPad, or I mean, whatever. But the child heard it. The child heard it. And if it works that way for children, it also works that way for adults. So therefore, I'm able to come in here and teach in a way that I cannot teach everywhere that I go. This coming June, Kathy and I will be going over and ministering in Ireland. You know, you talk about some of these ministry trips that you take, and a lot of people, I think they kind of misunderstand. It's like, oh, you know, Ireland, yeah, boy, have fun preaching, uh-huh. You know, they think of it in terms of a vacation, when the truth is, you know, you might get to see a few things here and there, but it's not a vacation. You know, when I go and minister places, I am perfectly happy staying in the room and just seeking the Lord and not seeing anything. So we're going to Ireland in June. And over there, I'll be ministering in a week's time. I'll be ministering in maybe 3, 4, 5 different churches. That's a challenge because you really have to seek God to find out, okay, I have one sermon in this church. My style is to teach more than just one sermon in a church. Therefore, God, you've got to help me keep this condensed in a way they can understand in one sermon. And what I have discovered is once you get outside of this church or our church, the prayer center in Tulsa, and really to an extent outside of this country, there is a tremendous lack of in-depth teaching. Tremendous lack, shockingly so. That means I have to be even more sensitive to the Lord because I can't just go in and start teaching something that I assume they already know, because that could breed confusion. So anyway, to be here is a real blessing. Your pastor said something here a few moments ago that is so appropriate for what we're going to be looking at this entire week. He mentioned about, you know, studying and preparing and then standing up in a pulpit to deliver the word, to deliver truth. And because of the study and the preparation and the prayer and so forth that goes into the delivering of the sermons, you can't just invite anybody to come in and minister. I have been invited over the years, invited to go and speak, you know, to a church. And I find out that the church has just had this parade of guest preachers coming in and ministering, and I know where these guest preachers are coming from. And I know, and sometimes after I preach, I find out who they've had in before me. And it's like, oh boy, you know, I contradicted everything that other guy just said. And literally, that has happened. That has happened. The difference, though, is how I taught what I taught. From a line upon line, precept upon precept perspective, and I could tell that some of the people were now scratching their heads thinking, wait a second, I'm seeing this in the Word. Well, anyway, what he shared about, you can't just invite anybody in. Okay, let's take that concept and look at it from a different angle. If your pastor feels like, and knows, He does not have the liberty before God. It's not just a conscience issue. It is an accountability issue before God. If he knows that he cannot just invite anybody into this building to preach, how much more so as we guard the church of our heart? In other words, how much liberty do we have to invite just anybody into our lives to preach? Do you understand the concept? If it's that critical for the pastor of a congregation, it is also that critical for the individual and his own heart. I'd like you to turn, first off, to Exodus chapter 40. Now this week, we are going to start where we start today, this morning, continue tonight, and build each service on what we've covered the previous services. I'm saying that now because when this service is over, you might have some questions relative to, well, I hear what you say, but what about, and what you're going to ask is going to be covered in the very next service. So I would say, you know, do your best to be here every service, not just for the sake of, so I can say, yeah, everybody was there, but I mean for your own sake relative to what I know God is going to do throughout this week. Now, here in Exodus 40, in verse 1, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, on the first day of the first month thou shalt set up the tabernacle of the tent of the congregation, and thou shalt put therein the ark of the testimony, and cover the ark with the veil, and thou shalt bring in the table, and set in order the things that are to be set in order upon it, and thou shalt bring in the candlestick, and light the lamps thereof. Now we'll stop right there because he continues in that theme, you know, for the remainder of this chapter. He's giving specific instructions about what to do. Keep your finger here and turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and we're going to look right at the very end of this chapter at one verse. We're jumping in the middle of a problem issue that Paul is addressing in this church. And it's really the latter half of the verse we're going to read that we want to focus on. And it's verse 34. He says, and if any man hunger, let him eat at home, that ye come not together unto condemnation. Now this is what we want to see. And the rest will I set in order when I come. Now, back here in Exodus, God was speaking to Moses, and he said, on the first day of the first month, thou shalt set up the tabernacle of the tent of the congregation. God gave Moses an instruction. He didn't just say, set it up. He said, the first day of the first month. That means if it was, you know, the fifth day of the last month, Moses had to wait all the way to the end of the month until we got to the first day of the first month. And that's not what happened, but I'm using that to illustrate. Meaning God gave him a specific instruction. Therefore, Moses knew he could not set this up any other day of any other month. He couldn't do it. The first day of the first month. Then he says, he gives some instructions, and he says in verse 3, you know, put therein the ark of the testimony, cover the ark with the veil, bring in the table, and set in order the things that are to be set in order upon it. Meaning, God had a specific order for these things to be done. Moses did not have the liberty to just go in and put everything in there the way he thought it was supposed to be in there. Do you understand this? He had, it's like, you know, okay, it's the day to move into the tent. And we got all the stuff ready. All right, come on, guys, let's start bringing this in. He didn't have that liberty. God gave him specific instructions on how to do this In fact, if you go back and read, he gave him specific instructions on how to make everything. But when it came time to put everything in the tent, he didn't just tell him, okay, there's an order in which these things need to be put in the tent. He went so far as to tell him, you do this on the first day of the first month. Then we read over there in Corinthians where Paul told the Corinthians, now let me just paraphrase big time. Corinthians, you guys have a lot of problems, and I'm dealing with this one at this time, but has to do with communion and so forth. But then he made a statement, when I get there, I will set everything else in order. Now, it wasn't that everything they were doing was wrong, but there was an order that had to be established in what they were doing. And the Apostle Paul said, when I get there, will set things in order. Now, here's what I'm getting at. There is an order that God has established for believers. An order that is critical to our lives. And we cannot afford to miss this order that he wants established. This is going to make, it's going to be so clear to you as we proceed forth this whole week. You're going to see, and we're going to be looking at this really from one specific perspective. Now turn over to Psalm 50. Psalm 50. See, one of the things that I have I've come to realize is that we as believers, we can come to a place of having an understanding about what we're supposed to do for God, or I'm a Christian, therefore I'm supposed to live like a Christian, so on and so forth. But we miss things that God has put in his word relative to how our lives should be set in order. Now let me just throw out a disclaimer. There is a lot of weird teaching in the body of Christ about spiritual alignment. Now maybe you've heard it, maybe you haven't. But I want to tell you right now, that is not what we're going to be talking about this week. There is some wacko teaching out there about, you know, getting in alignment and so forth. And some of it actually borders into the area of like astrology and so forth. I mean, it's just totally, totally crazy. All right. Well, we're not going in that direction. But nevertheless, here in Psalm 50, I want you to go all the way to the end of this chapter. And take a look at verse 23. It says, whoso offereth praise glorifieth me, and to him that ordereth his conversation aright will I show the salvation of God. Now, for those of you that are younger, this was actually a song that we sang years ago when Kathy and I first got married. We're in, you know, the charismatic church, and you know, whoso offereth praise glorifieth me, whoso offereth praise glorifieth me, and to him who ordereth his conversation aright will I show the salvation of God. I came to glorify his name. They'd start singing that song. They got into it so much. Well, see, that was a song that we sang. But we really didn't know everything we were singing. The first part of this verse says, whoso offereth praise glorifieth me. Okay, well, hallelujah. I like that. And I know that. So I'll praise you and glorify you. But now look at this last part. And to him that ordereth his conversation aright, will I show the salvation of God? Now we need to break this down a little bit to have a deeper understanding of the image that's being presented here. First off, before I get into this, I want to give you a real brief, instruction, teaching about researching Greek and Hebrew words. When you begin to take a look at the words in the original language, whether it was Hebrew or Greek, you can look up the meanings of the words and come away with a complete misunderstanding of what has been written in Scripture. Now let me give you a very simple illustration. Let's say that I write a letter to you. And I write the letter in chapter and verse, you know, very similar to the way we have Scripture. And so you're reading my letter, and in verse 3, I write, Pastor Bronk indeed is very green. Okay? Well, you like, yeah, he's green. Well, what's that mean? So you get out your Greek and your Hebrew, you know, dictionaries, and you look this up, and you say, oh, okay, well, let's see, green. That can mean that he's envious. It can mean that he is environmentally conscious. It can mean that he's sick. It can mean that he is green, the color. Now, you've taken verse 3 and you've seen that word and you've looked up the meaning of that word and you've noticed, well, it could mean four different things. Well, I wonder what dear Brother Martin meant in verse 3. How you use the word green is going to be based on your personal chosen interpretation of that word relative to what you know, think, believe, and feel about Pastor Bronk. Do you understand what I'm saying? So if you don't like him, you will say, Pastor Jim is telling us that Pastor Bronk is green. He's very inexperienced. Well, see, we know that's not true. But if you had read verses 1 and 2 of my letter, you would understand verse 3. Because in verse 1, I wrote to you and said, I went over to visit Pastor Bronk, and when I got there, he happened to be painting the soffit of his house. Verse 2 says, and when he climbed down from the ladder, he bumped into it and knocked the can of paint on his head. Pastor Bronk is indeed green. Okay, you see what I mean? Now you know the proper use of the word green in my letter. That same principle holds true with the Greek and the Hebrew. Because if you do not, you see, you can look up the word and you can say, this word means, and you will be 100% correct. However, what does that word mean in the context of the message, of the chapter, of the book, of the Bible? Yeah. See what I mean? Yeah. This is why you cannot simply and exclusively go by the original language definition. That's right. And I have been in services where I've sat and I've been listening to somebody preach and teach, and they'll say, okay, now this word in the Greek means, and they give a definition of the word. And I'm sitting there thinking and listening, it's like, hold on, buddy, you know, you're right. However, there's more to that definition which qualifies the use of that word in that passage concerning the message that the writer is trying to get across. That is very critical. Now, that's something that you need to keep in mind when you're doing your word studies, because if you just do nothing but get a definition of the word, but you don't understand the context of the message, you will misunderstand and sometimes come up with a wrong teaching concerning what you've read. Now, in this verse, God says to him that ordereth his conversation aright, will I show the salvation of God? All right, let's start here with this word, ordereth. Now remember in Exodus 40, we read where God said, set these things in order. And then we read over in Corinthians where Paul said, when I arrive, I will set these things in order. In both of those situations, that word order, both in the Old and the New Testament, it's talking about somebody doing something to cause something outside their life to be put in order. For example, with the Apostle Paul, I'm going to come there and I'm going to tell you guys what you need to do to get everything in order. For Moses, I have to set in order these things of the temple. Okay, but this word shows us something a little bit differently. This word order that comes from the Hebrew word sum. And what it means is the individual's effort for the individual's self. Meaning, I am setting something in order in me, not in you, or not in a temple. Do you understand what I'm saying? I'm focusing on my life, and it is my responsibility to bring this, whatever, in order in my life. God is saying here, whoso to him, that individual, me, who ordereth, who takes responsibility for himself to set something in order. God's not going to do it for you. However, God will provide the information you need to do it for yourself. And so he says to him, to that person, now we're reading this relative to the body of Christ. Another thing that'll help you with your Bible study is this. All throughout the Old Testament, technically, the entire Old Testament contains a message for the body of Christ. Now, sometimes you have to dig into it. But there is a message, a type and shadow. Okay, think of it like this. God's original intent for humans was to exist in his image and likeness. That's in Genesis chapter 1. Okay, that has never changed. So therefore, what we see in the Old Testament contained in these writings are references to what God really wants for mankind. The goal is for us to live and exist in the image and likeness of God. Okay, now here, if we look at this from a body of Christ perspective, he's saying to the Christian, you have to take responsibility for your own life, and you have to do what is necessary to bring into order something. Okay, well, what is the something that we have to bring into order? He says conversation. Now, this word conversation, it's not simply what comes out of your mouth. The word conversation, it comes from the Hebrew word derek, and it means, in short, way of life. The sum total of how you live your life. Everything about your life here on earth, not just what you say, but your lifestyle. And then he says, to him that ordereth his conversation aright, or sets it in order correctly, will I show. This word show, it comes from the word ra'ah, and it means to perceive, gain understanding, to be fully aware. In other words, if you will take responsibility for your own life to set the sum total of your life in order, then that is going to put you in a place to receive revelation, understanding, comprehension, a full awareness of something. Well, what is the something that we will comprehend, perceive, be fully aware of? And he tells you right here, the salvation of God. The salvation of God. Now, this is interesting. This word salvation, it comes from the Hebrew word yesha, Y-E-S-H-A. That's very similar to Y-E-S-H-U-A. In the Hebrew, those two words are related, absolutely related. And the word yesha in this verse, it means liberty, deliverance, freedom, welfare, prosperity. In other words, our inheritance in Christ. And now notice what he says here. To him that ordereth his conversation aright, will I. Who is the I? It's God. And he's saying, to those of you who will put forth the individual effort to get your life in Christ, in order, or lined up the way God describes it, then I, God, will be able to give you the full comprehension, the full understanding, the full perception, the full awareness, not just of salvation. He adds the two words of God to let us know this isn't just some kind of an earthly salvation, an earthly deliverance, or an earthly freedom or whatever. He's saying, I'm going to make sure that you understand the fullness of the salvation that comes only from me, Almighty God. This is a work that only I can do in your life. And you will come to the place of understanding the fullness, literally, of who you are in Christ. Now, if you look over in Ephesians chapter 1, we'll see a variation of this theme. Or I guess we could say we'll see it kind of referenced, if you will, what I've just shared with you from Psalm 50. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15. Wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints, ceased not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know, fully comprehend, grasp, realize, have no doubt about what is the hope of his calling, and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding power of the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. This is the expanded version of what we just read. I will show you the salvation of God. And here we're seeing a description of this salvation. In other words, you're going to come to the place of knowing who you are in Christ. You're going to come to the place of understanding what you can do in Christ and what Christ can do in you. You're going to come to the place of understanding your potential as a believer. It's a lack of this understanding which has led to so many wrong doctrines in the church. You know, I was raised in church to believe you must be born again. However, I was also raised to believe tongues are not for today. Okay, well, why did anybody teach me that? It's because they had not received that full revelation, comprehension, understanding, assurance, knowledge of the salvation of God. Because in our salvation, God has made available to us the gift of being able to pray in tongues. That's a part of it. And see, even today, people will fuss and argue about this. People will say something like, well, you know, I can get everything that I need by praying with the understanding. I don't need to pray in tongues. Well, okay, if that's true, then why does Scripture say otherwise? What's happened is, it's not that you're some kind of lost degenerate. It just means that you have not come to the place of receiving this revelation, this understanding. Now, God says to the individual who sets his life in order, I will be able to give that person the revelation of the fullness of their salvation. See, years ago, when I was, again, being raised in church, to us, the word saved was exactly the same thing as the term born again. And that's how we lived. Are you saved? Yep. You're born again? Yep. Well, we figured it was the same thing. Well, later on, I'm in the Word and I'm reading and I'm thinking, wait a second. Born again is an event. Salvation is the gift that comes with being born again. Salvation is the inheritance of the born again person. Born again, and I'm not trying to diminish born again, but born again is the, that's just the moment that you passed from spiritual death to spiritual life. You accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And as we say it, you know, the blood has washed away our sin. And on the inside of us, there is now a new man, a new spiritual person on the inside. Okay, that is born again. Jesus said, you must be born again. He did not say you have to be living in the fullness of your salvation. Now, some of you are like, what? By his stripes, you were healed. That's a part of our salvation. The peace that passes all understanding, that is a part of our salvation. The mind of Christ, that is a part of our salvation. Joy unspeakable and full of glory. That is a part of our salvation. I mean, I could go on and on with this. That's all a part of our salvation. But born again is the moment that we have accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Born again is the moment that you become a spiritual babe in Christ. Okay, from that point on, we should be learning about salvation and what happened when we got born again. It's a whole different process. Well, see, God is saying here, if you will get your life in order, get things established in your life the way I want them to be established, then I'm going to be able to give you a revelation of your salvation. I'm going to be able to present to you what you have in Jesus Christ. You know, we talk about glory to God. We're seated with him in heavenly places. Okay, well, what does that mean? Well, it means we're seated with him in heavenly places. Okay, well, the last time I looked, you were sitting in that chair. You're not up there with him. Well, yeah, but Brother Martin, it's just a, you know, a figure of speech. Seriously? You think the Bible is full of figures of speech? No. God doesn't waste words. He doesn't have time for that. Well, I guess really he does. He's God. You know, he's been around for a long time. Let me say it like this. He's not going to waste our time with a book full of figures of speech. There is a reason these things are in Scripture. What does it mean when it says that we're seated? I'm not teaching on that this week, but there's a reason it says that. Briefly, we talk about Jesus is on the throne at the right hand of God. But God says we are seated with him in spiritual, heavenly, wonderful, glorious places. The literal image that presents is this. Let me say it this way. God's got a throne. Jesus has a throne. Jesus' throne is next to God's. But we're seated with him. That means we are all sitting on the same throne with Jesus. That's blasphemy. No, that's scripture. You know, move over. I'm sitting here. That's not blasphemy. That is God trying to give us a revelation of our salvation, who we are. Now you say, well, yes, but we're not deity. He didn't say we're deity, and neither did I. He says, you're seated with my son next to me. Next to me. See that whole thing of, you know, your joint heirs with Jesus Christ? Well, see, when we start using that word heirs and inheritance, we start thinking in terms of, boy, I got some money. Glory to God.
I can't wait to move into my new inheritance here on earth. That big house that he's got, it's out there somewheres. I'll be, no, no. We have inherited, part of our inheritance is that position with Christ seated at the right hand of God and his throne. But you're not deity. See, this is a part of what God is trying to get across to us. I will show you. I will give you a revelation of your salvation. I'll help you understand what it means to be a brother to Jesus. I'll help you understand what it means when I said in my word, as he is, so are we in this world. I'll help you understand this. See, it's a lack of this understanding that's caused so many of us to be messed up in our lives. And let me say it like this. We can only live in the fullness of our salvation to the degree that we have received the full revelation of our salvation. So if I fully understand 10% of my salvation, okay, hopefully I'll walk in that 10%. But that means there's 90% of my salvation that I don't yet fully understand. And God says, if you get your life in order, I will be able to make it clear to you. Now, some people might be thinking, well, I guess I got to quit my smoking and my drinking and my chewing and my, well, that'll help. You're on the right track. But that's not where we're headed here. We have to be the ones to establish this order in our lives. God will not do it for us. Okay, now, if God says, and to him that ordereth, meaning take charge of your life. You are the general. Take charge of your life. Order it. Ordereth his life. Puts it in order, then I'm going to be able to help him understand these things. If God's going to tell us that, then surely he's going to help us understand what does it mean to get our lives in order. All right, let's take a look. Turn over to Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24. We're going to look at one verse here in Luke 24, verse 49. Jesus says, "And now this is after his resurrection, and he's soon going to ascend back to the Father. He says in verse 49, and behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high." All right, now look over in Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1. Now look at what Jesus said in verse 8. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Well, praise God. Power. I want power. Ooh, I want power. Yes, because if I have power, people will listen to me. Come on. If I have power, I shall be somebody. Yes. I want power. So, when's the next How to Get More Power seminar? Now, I'm partially exaggerating here. All right, now, Jesus said we'll receive power, did he not? I am in 100% agreement with him. He said we receive power. All right, we've settled that issue. We shall receive power. But now let's compare that to something else. Turn over to Ephesians 4. Ephesians chapter 4. And take a look beginning in verse 11. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ.
Why did he do that? Very simple, Brother Martin. So we could get power. Is that what it says? No. It says, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, making increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. Okay, you know what I don't see in here is power. What I do see in here is that we're supposed to come to this place of unity concerning the faith. Now this phrase, the faith, it's not talking about we walk by faith, not by sight, and raise the dead in the process. It's talking about the revelation of the born-again experience and salvation. The sum total of what is given as far as teaching is concerned to the body of Christ. And he says, till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, mature, the measure, the stature, the fullness of Christ, that we're not, you know, led astray to, you know, all these crazy doctrines, so on and so forth. The focus here is not power. The focus here is, now let me say it relative to this teaching today. Get your life in order. You take charge and set your life in order. Grow up into him in what? All things. What all things? Literally, the sum total of salvation. The salvation of God. Okay, now, we cannot deny that Jesus Christ himself said, you shall receive power. You're going to receive power. So we're in total agreement with that. But now, there's more in the New Testament about growing up in him and the word and correct doctrine, if you will, than there is on power. Far more. In fact, a lot of people want to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and talk about, you know, the gifts of the Spirit. But what they miss is that keeping everything in order, start in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and go through the whole book, and you're going to find out by the time that you get to chapter 12, he's talking about putting things in order and the order in which the gifts manifest and the reason why they're manifesting. It's not simply to experience the power of their manifestation. Okay, now in this, he says, power, no doubt. Luke 24, Acts chapter 1. And then we see the evidence of power taking place in the book of Acts. We see miracles and healings and so on and so forth. However, power will not result in God's order being established in the life of a Christian. And beyond that, when you put power as a priority over growing up, you are now out of order. You're completely out of order. Now, as I was, Kathy and I were born again, we're in a charismatic church. Yes, we saw demonstrations of power. Well, the focus, and I'm not going to say that this is the way it was taught to us from our pastor, but when you keep hearing, seeing power, power this, power that, gifts this, gifts that, and that's the conversation among believers and so forth. What happens? Well, you end up wanting this power. In fact, we hear a lot about, you know, well, when we have this demonstration of power and, you know, the dead are raised, the blind see, and all this other, you know, revival's going to happen. I'm not going to refute that. I'm not going to dispute that a demonstration of power will help lead people to Jesus Christ. Okay, but the other side of this pulpit is the fact that if you read in the book of Acts especially, you're going to find that there were demonstrations of power And people still rose up against the preacher. There were miracles that took place, and people still rose up against the preacher. In other words, it is a contradiction of the image that is sometimes presented to us. Now, I'm not trying to refute anybody's teaching. Please don't misunderstand me. But what I'm saying is, when we focus so much on the power, how can I get more power? How can I get more power? Gotta have that anointing. Gotta get that anointing. You know, if I pray in tongues, I'm going to get that greater anointing. Well, I'm not going to deny that, but praying in tongues is a teaching gift more than it is a give you lots of power so you can put on a show gift. See what I'm saying? So now what I need to do when I'm going to get my life in order, and please, really, when I say keep saying over and over again, don't misunderstand me. The reason I say that is because inevitably, well, I heard what he said, and he said, no, he didn't say that either. If I'm going to get my life in order, what I need to do is diminish my focus on getting power and increase my focus on getting my life in order and growing up in him. When that becomes my order, I then begin to receive a greater understanding of my salvation. See, I'm firmly convinced that one of the reasons we're not seeing more power is not because we don't have it. It's because our lives are out of order and we don't understand it. Did he not say, you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you? Well, now see, I'm somebody standing here. The Holy Ghost has come upon me. I have had my own personal day of Pentecost. I didn't hear a rushing mighty wind. There weren't cloven tongues like as a fire upon my head, but I did have that experience with the evidence of speaking in tongues. So guys, I have the power. And you do too with a similar experience. So the power is there. But maybe we're just not in order the way we think so that the power can flow. God said in his word, we all read it earlier, to him who ordereth his conversation aright, will I give a revelation of the fullness of his salvation. See this? So maybe I've got some things in my life that need to be tweaked to get better in order so that I have a better comprehension of the power that I'm supposed to utilize. Think about this. This is one that stumped me for a long time. It seems like it was so easy to move in power in the New Testament. Doesn't it? This is a lot. We don't want to talk about that. You know, the apostles, you know, they get born again. Jesus is raised from the dead, and they get born again. Then a few days later, they get filled with the Holy Ghost. Next thing you know, silver and gold have I none. Such as I have, give unto thee in the name of Jesus, you know, rise and walk. It's like, well, that was easy. What's the deal? Their lives were in order. Their lives were in order more than what we have been led to understand. Better way to say it, maybe, more than what we've been taught. Their lives were in order. Some people seem to have this idea that you have to sell out to Jesus, and you do, but their definition of selling out is not necessarily the way we're supposed to sell out. You have some of these guys out there, they basically sacrificed their families to sell out to Jesus. It's like, well, you know what? God's going to move in your life as much as he possibly can, but he's not going to destroy a family in the process. Something was out of order. See what I mean? Now, here in this, what we're seeing here is that we need to prioritize or get things in order in our lives. So I need to have this focus on growing up into him more than this focus on getting power. Now look over in Matthew 24. Matthew 24. Now, we're not going to be reading what I'm going to reference here, but I am going to make a reference to something while you're turning to Matthew 24. There's a place there where Jesus is teaching, and he says, you know, the day is going to come when there are going to be people standing before me, and they're going to say, hey, you know, I got people healed in your name. And, you know, devils got cast out in your name. In other words, there was a demonstration of God's power in my life by your name. But yet Jesus is going to look at them and say, depart from me, for I never knew you. Now you'd think if people are going around in the name of Jesus, be healed, their lives are in order, right? Now, some of you guys, you've been around this church too long. It's like, no, not really, Brother Martin. We know, we know better than that. Okay, play along. Pretend you have never heard this man teach, okay? But this is true, though. When we see power being demonstrated through people, we tend to have this idea they're further along in God than I am, right? Translation, or said differently for this teaching, they have their lives in order more than what I do. But that's not necessarily true. Because if you have people who are going to legitimately say, but Jesus, you know, I got people healed in your name, cast out devils in your name, raised the dead in your name, did all kinds of great things in your name. And then Jesus is going to look at them and say, I never knew you. I never knew you. I'm not going to be teaching on that passage and breaking all that down, but this means it's possible to operate in power and still miss out at the end. But if you have your life in order, even if there is no power being demonstrated, you make it. You make it. See this? So that's why, for me personally now, you know, for years it's like, man, I want the anointing too. Oh, come on, God, give me some. I want to have a prayer line, and when I lay hands on people, I want them to fall, okay? It makes me look so good. Seriously, I mean, that's kind of how I used to feel. Anymore, I'm going to pray for you. If you fall, it better be God, because I am not going to push on you. Well, now, here in Matthew 24, in verse 3, it says that Jesus, he's sitting upon the Mount of Olives, and the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be, and when shall be the end, the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world. So Jesus is giving them an answer, and this answer pertains to his return and the end of the world. Meaning, I'm not sure how these guys interpreted what he said. In other words, their perception of a time frame, but the time frame he's presenting goes way beyond their lives unto now and beyond now. And so Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. In other words, I am a representative of Jesus Christ. And out of that they shall deceive many. Well, for just a moment here, they're saying that they're representing Jesus Christ, and then they're going to deceive many people. Who are the people that are going to be deceived? Only the ones who listen to those saying, I am of Jesus Christ. So who are the people who are actively listening to those who say, I represent Jesus? It's you and me. I mean, think about this. The lost are protesting in the streets over the name of Jesus. They don't want to hear it. Don't preach to me. Don't tell me what's right and wrong. I want to do what I want to do, and that's just how it is. And any politician who tries to tell me otherwise, I'll burn cars in the street. Yeah. So just, do you see what I'm saying? The lost are not flocking to hear these people speak, but we do.
Yeah.
And so he says, many are going to come in my name, saying, Jesus has sent me. I represent Jesus. I'm teaching the teachings of Christ, but they shall deceive many. Verse 11, and many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. And then if you look over in verse 24, for there shall arise false Christs and false prophets and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. In other words, if the very elect are deceivable, let alone, you know, the common Christian, you know, the very elect. If the very elect are deceivable, they're going to be deceived. Well, that means you and I also have the potential to be deceived. That's the message he's trying to get across here. But in verse 13, he says, he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. Okay, endure what? Endure the earthquakes and the pestilence and the wars and the... No, he that shall endure the overly impressive operation of these false prophets and what they're declaring. See, where he says here in verse 24, you know, they're going to show great signs and wonders. The power is not that which deceives. The power is that which sets people up to receive the teaching that deceives. Do you see what I'm saying? And think about it. Guys, that's the way it is now. You know, if you know, Brother Flabbermouth comes to Immokalee and puts up his tent and word begins spreading. Grandma got healed. Junior got healed. Why? There was this and there was that. I mean, people start talking about the demonstration of power. You and I both know. People are going to be flocking to this. Even the people that don't believe in this stuff are going to show up to try and discredit it, but they're going to be there because the word of the demonstration of power begins to spread and people are attracted to that. And so people show up, and when they show up, they're showing up for the show, but because power is being demonstrated, they now open up the sanctuary of their life for the teaching to deceive. See this? Eliminate the power, and you eliminate a lot of the people who are deceived. See what I mean about that thing? We've got it reversed. And so when he says, those that endure to the end shall be saved, or they're going to make it through the final judgment and be received unto me. Those who endure the highly impressive, misleading, good sounding, etc., so forth, teaching of the false prophets, if you stand strong, let me say it another way, if you have your life in order, you will be able to stand strong through all of this stuff that is taught and leading so many people away, and you will endure to the end. And this is what we're going to be looking at through this entire week, is getting our lives in order relative to this perspective. And I'm going to show you in Scripture where God has laid out what we can do to endure to the end. I'm going to be showing you some things in Scripture that other people would want to refute, because it's not that I'm any better than anybody else, but it's here in the Word. And I'm going to explain to you why it is, I'm going to be showing you from the Word, why it is that some people refute a revelation of salvation teaching, not the born again teaching, but the sum total package. You know, here's what salvation is. Why some people refuse to accept this, I'm going to be showing you from Scripture why that is. Because, guys, look, I don't know how many people who call themselves Christians are going to be in heaven or be in eternity on the new heaven, the new earth. Because when Jesus says that even the very elect could be deceived, when Jesus says, hey, yeah, I know, I mean, there were some power things that happened in your life, but, dude, you didn't have your life in order. Now, he's not going to say, you know, dude, you didn't have that. But look, one thing you don't want to hear when you stand before Jesus is depart from me. I mean, I'd rather hear, okay, you know what? You can come on in. You weren't that faithful, and you didn't do that well, but at least you endured. Come on in, okay? I would willingly give up any and all rewards, any and all, you know, crowns, or, I mean, I would just get in there. You know what I'm saying? Because the one thing I don't want to hear is depart from me. Because the moment you hear those words, that's it. It's over. There's no opportunity for repentance. You burn forever. It's done. So I need to get my life in order. Now listen, what I'm sharing with you this week, the last thing that you need to leave here thinking is, well, that Brother Martin, boy, I'll tell you what, he must have his life in order. No, I'm ordering my conversation aright. In other words, I'm understanding this, and I'm getting my life more and more in order to understand the fullness of what Jesus Christ gave me at the moment I was born again. Praise the Lord. Please stand. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for your word. And speaking for myself personally, Father, to me, it is so exciting when I get into your word and it's like you begin peeling back layer after layer of just one verse and helping me see things in ways that I'd never seen them before. There is no end to the gold mine of your word. We can just continue digging and digging and digging and find incredible spiritual wealth. Father, I pray that every person who is truly able to be here for all of these services, that they will be here. That, Father, anything that comes up in their life that to them seems like a legitimate reason to not be here when they could be here, Father, may the red lights be flashing. May they realize, now wait a second, no, I'm going to get this night in order in my life, and I'm going to be there for these services. And Jesus, we give you the glory for this because there's no way, absolutely no way, Jesus, that we could hear this kind of teaching if it weren't for you. So I thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Holy Spirit. I thank you, God. I thank you, Father. I thank you for your word, for the Bible. Father, I give you the praise for this. And already, Father, in my heart, I am sensing that change is taking place in people's lives. And I thank you and praise you for this. Father, I thank you for the healings that took place earlier in this service. I thank you, Father, for people that maybe physically, their bodies were saying, you can't get out of bed. You've got to stay. I thank you for healing manifesting and them being here even tonight. I give you the praise for this. And Father, as we leave this place this morning, I am asking that you minister to our hearts and our minds to receive from you what it is you know we need to receive in all of these services. And Father, most of all, I thank you that my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So thoroughly enjoyed that, and I know you did too. I heard the amens. I heard people joining in. And so these are so applicable to where we're at, what our vision is, because what we say continually, what our vision is not first place revival. Our vision is first place to be formed into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ, in word and in spirit, to be formed into his image. And so this is a week of destiny. It really is, because it adds more pieces to the, I can say this before the Lord. I do not ask Jim and Kathy to come down here just because we want to have a good time. My absolute, before God, our number one objective is to add line on line, precept on precept to our destiny here in Immokalee. And this is part of our destiny, to be formed first and foremost into his image. The power will follow in Jesus' name. Blessings on you and your families. Be back at 6 o'clock tonight. We love you so much. Amen.